the prayer, and we'll post that on the website. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, who created us in your image, grant us grace fearlessly to contend against evil and to make no peace with oppression, and that we may reverently use our freedom, help us to employ it in the maintenance of justice in our communities and among the nations, to the glory of your holy name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
I guess this is me. Good evening, everybody. I've been really excited for all of these presentations, because children's books aren't just for children, they're for adults and bring up so many different conversations. So I chose James 2. My brother, show no partiality as you hold the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. For if a man wearing a gold ring and fine clothing comes into your assembly, and a poor man in shabby clothing also comes in, and if you pay attention to the one who wears the fine clothing and say, you sit here in a good place, while you say to the poor man, you stand over there or sit down at my feet, have you not then made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? And for me, this spoke so well towards race, racism, and how we treat others who we prejudge, where our prejudice and our bias come in as being worthy or unworthy. And unfortunately, I think that's where our world, what we're in right now, and seeing these things through everything that we've gone through, even with the pandemic, those communities who are readily able to get the vaccine and those communities that are not readily able to get the vaccine. So that is why I chose this, because I find that this is what's happening. We're judging, and really when we judge and we, based on looks, socioeconomic, class, whatever, those thoughts are evil, because we were all made in the eyes of our Lord. So there is no one who is better than the other. Okay, so I chose this book, something,
That's okay, go ahead,
Crystal. I chose this book because my students, with everything that happened last year and that have been happening, that has been happening with police shootings, it's been on my children. My students are in fifth grade, so they're very aware of things. And this was just a good book to bring to their attention and for them to discuss what they're feeling, what they're seeing in a safe place. And to also, it just ties in racial injustice and how they deal with it and what happens within the story. So with that being said.
Okay.
Peace and welcome to our story time, brought to you by our Niagara Falls Underground Railroad Heritage Center and produced by the Atlanta School for Gifted Youngsters. You know, kids, reading is very important because through books you can learn about yourself and the world around you. Through our story time, we're going to share with you some amazing books, and I know you're going to enjoy today's story. So grab your healthy snacks, sit on back, and enjoy today's story. Something happened in our town, a child's story about racial injustice. By Marianne Celano, Marietta Collins, and Ann Hazard. illustrated by Jennifer Zivion. This story is read with permission by Imagination Press. Something bad happened in our time. The news was on the TV, the radio, and the internet. The grown-ups didn't think the kids knew about it. But the kids in Miss Garcia's class heard some older kids talking about it, and they had questions. After school, Emma asked her mother, "Why did the police shoot that man?" "It was a mistake," said her mother. "I feel sorry for the man and his family." "Yes, the police thought he had a gun," said her father. "It wasn't a mistake," said her sister Liz. "The cops shot him because he was black." Emma was confused. "He is brown, not black," she said. "Some black people have dark brown skin and some have light brown skin," Emma's father explained. "Black usually means African American. Most of their ancestors were brought here from Africa as slaves." "I know what a slave is," said Emma. "That's when you have to do whatever the other person says." "Yes, slaves had to do whatever white people told them to do. Even after slavery ended, white people didn't let black people live where they wanted, go to school with white people, or vote." "Who are white people?" "White people came from places in Europe or Russia or other countries. We are white people, even though our skin is light tan." "Did our family do those bad things a long time ago?" Emma asked. "Yes," answered her mother. "Back then, many white people thought that they were better than black people, even though it wasn't true." Liz added, "Some white people still think most black men and boys are dangerous, even though they're not." "Was the man that got shot dangerous?" asked Emma. "No," her mother said. "Shooting him was a mistake. It was a mistake that is part of a pattern." "Like a pattern on my blanket?" Emma asked. "Yes, but this pattern is being nice to white people and mean to black people. It's an unfair pattern. Suppose you had a birthday party and invited everyone in your class except the black kids," her mother said. "How would the black kids feel?" "They would be sad," Emma said, "or mad. And you would be missing out because you never know who is going to be your best friend," said Liz. "And you can help others to be fair," said her mother. "Like telling Anna to stop teasing Ling about her name?" asked Emma. Her mother gave her a hug. "Yes, just like that." In another house, Josh asked his mother, "Can police go to jail?" "Yes," said his mother. "Why do you ask?" "That white policeman who shot the black man," said Josh, "will he go to jail?" "What he did was wrong," said his mother. "But he won't go to jail," said his father. "Why not?" asked Josh. "Cops stick up for each other," said Josh's brother Malcolm, "and they don't like black men." Josh was confused. "Why not? Some police are black." "You're right," said his mother. "Uncle James is a police officer, and so is my friend Kenya." "There are many cops, black and white, who make good choices," said his father, "but you can't count on them to always do what's right." Malcolm added, "I can get stopped by the police just because I'm black, even if I don't do anything wrong." "That's not fair," Josh said. "What if it was a white man in a car? Would the police have shot him?" "They probably wouldn't even have stopped the car," said his father. "Sometimes white people are treated better than black people," said his mother. "But it's not right. Everybody should be treated fairly." Josh's mother gave him a hug. "We're proud of who we are. Harriet Tubman, Martin Luther King Jr., and Nelson Mandela were strong and brave Black leaders. They showed us that we can stand up for our rights and set good examples for others. They were treated unfairly, but helped others learn to be more fair. "Some people haven't learned," said his father angrily. "Why are you mad?" asked Josh. "I'm mad that we're still treated poorly sometimes, but I can use my anger to make things better," said his father. "Black people have a lot of power if we work together to make changes." "I have power," Josh said, "and I'm smart." His father smiled. "You're right," his mother added, "and you can change people's hearts by sticking up for someone who is not treated fairly." "Like Malcolm sticks up for me when the kids tease me about my glasses?" Josh asked. "He tells them to step off, just like that," his parents said. The next day, a new kid joined Emma and Josh's class. His name was Omad, and he was from a country far away. Omad didn't know where to sit or what to do because it was his first day in school. He talked a little bit, but it was hard to understand him. He said he was learning English. After lunch, the class went outside to play soccer. Daniel and Sophia picked kids to be on their teams. All of the kids were picked to be on a team except Omad. Daniel said Omad probably didn't know how to play because he was new. Sophia said Omad might not be good at soccer. Josh remembered what his mother said about sticking up for people who were treated unfairly. Emma remembered what her mother said about unfair patterns and birthday parties. All of a sudden, Omad wasn't alone. Emma and Josh were leading him to their team. "We have enough kids on our team," Daniel said. "We don't need him." But Josh was ready. "Step off," he said. "He's playing." "Yeah," said Emma. "We don't want to miss out." And just like that, Emma and Josh gained a new friend and started a better pattern in their school.
So this is such a, I love this book because there are so many ways discussions can go. And I typically just open it up to the kids and, "So what are you thinking?" And depending on the class, depending on the kids, but it all ties into standing up and that some people don't do the right thing, but there is good and there is bad in every group. So typically when I lead a class discussion, I just open the floor up to whoever wants to say, what do you think? What are your thoughts, feelings, or connections? And then that just organically leads to so many different conversations. So some of these questions I do ask them. We've had discussions on police shootings, and depending on the class, depending on the kids, their responses are interesting, and they have learned how to go back and forth with their discussion. So again, these are just some thoughts that you can talk about in your breakout room. I wonder what it's saying to me. When and how you've challenged racism. And again, that's one that is very interesting. And I always give my viewpoint and what has happened to me and how I've maybe not upheld and maybe I have. So these are just some of the questions that you can talk about because you don't have to answer all of them. Pick a couple or whatever it is you want to talk about regarding the book is entirely up to you and your group.
And I just want to remind everybody just to take a look at these guidelines that we've been using each week for our breakout room discussions as a reminder of how we respectfully handle those breakout rooms, speaking from our own experiences, listening generously to each other, not making assumptions, resist making assumptions about each other, refrain from fixing, saving, advising, or correcting each other, especially being mindful of taking space and making space to ensure everyone has an opportunity to speak and listen. So if there are five people in your breakout room, you want to be sure that all of you have a chance to share. Expect and accept non-closure. Be willing to be challenged to disrupt racial patterns, both by the activities and discussion by other participants. And we will respect the confidentiality of personal information and stories that we share in the breakout room, which will not be recorded. And these are the questions again. And some of you have received these questions in advance. So those of you who did, perhaps you can help facilitate the conversations. And I'm going to stop share and simply make sure everybody has been assigned to a room. Okay. We will have 20 minutes. They'll give you a countdown of 60 seconds, in which case everybody will return. So are there any questions? Father Duncan, how about room two?
Thank you for this book, Crystal. This was wonderful.
You're welcome. It's a great book. So many conversations can be had with this book on so many different levels. So I enjoyed the conversation in my group tremendously. Oh, am I supposed to still speak?
Thank you.
You know, we were talking that going forward, we would love, and Rob had said, to just meet and have these discussions for longer than 20 minutes, because 20 minutes just flies by. We would love to go forward and continue the discussion. We learned, you know, experiences that we didn't know about, how people weren't aware, and simply not because they don't want to know, it's because it wasn't their lived experience. And when it's not your lived experience, it doesn't affect you. And that's not a bad thing. It's just, you know, you're fortunate that you don't have to go through and endure certain things. So that's what we came up. We would love to continue these talks. But I think, I don't know, does anybody else have anything to say or add?
Crystal, might a number of these people who are interested in having more of these conversations be interested in taking sacred ground first? Because I think it's such a wonderful, you know, way to go from where we are to having these conversations. And I see Leslie shaking her head vigorously. Leslie, you think it might be a good bridge?
I think it's an excellent bridge, Heather. And it's for those of you who have not taken it, it's an incredible program. And the dialogue that it fosters is all the dialogue we should be having now. It's really wonderful. I actually look forward to taking it again. It's that rich. Yeah. There's that much in it.
And actually, we started discussion about perhaps having an alumni group where we'll continue. Crystal, just as people are saying, continue to have the conversations, because that's what we need to do, to continue talking. Yeah.
Hey, Crystal, could I ask you a question?
Sure.
I would love to use some of these books, both in our nursery school and in our Sunday school. And I'd just like to talk to you about, and maybe with Christine, about how we implement that, because you don't want to go over the kid's head either. You know, you want to have age-appropriate books and whatnot. So maybe we could talk about that a little bit, but I would love to do a whole series with our kids on these books, both in the nursery school, which are, as you know, very young, and also do it in our Sunday school class.
Oh yeah, I would love.
That's what we had discussed at our racial reconciliation group, as you recall. And Crystal may help us distinguish the younger books, because for these younger kids, you know, I think this one, some kids would get it, but it might still be a little old for them. Maybe some of the older Sunday school kids.
I think the younger kids focus more towards the end of the book, where their friend, he's not on the soccer team.
Right, right.
You know, because they really, I think they weave in the shooting. They kind of segue it into where there are mistakes. And so I think younger grades focus on that aspect of it. But yeah, I would be willing to help out with that.
Good.
And I think sometimes we don't realize how smart four-year-olds are. I know in our STEM classes, I always go in there to see what they're doing in STEM class, because these kids are building rockets and they're four-year-olds, and the stuff that they're doing is utterly amazing. Their brains are so eager to learn at that age, and they're so wide open to all the different possibilities. I have found it to be an incredible, preschool is an incredible age. Anne could maybe say more about that, but I think they can do more than you think they can do.
Maybe they could write a book.
They're sponges. And I think they're more aware of what's going on in the world, because when we grew up, there was no TikTok. There was the social media. They hear more because it's out there more. Mm-hmm. And they're aware. They might have different words and to describe their feelings, but they're pretty well aware at that age of what's going on in the world.
Pat, could you share the book you shared with us? Pat Ahmad? You're on mute.
And who is the author?
Pat, you're muted. And I actually have the list that Crystal sent to some people, which I think would be a good starting point. But Pat, unmute so you can tell us some more about the book you did.
Oh, no. Rob was talking about, Pat had shared, and I have the same book, Uncomfortable Conversations with a Black Man, Emmanuel Acho. He was actually a football player.
Yeah, sure.
And it's an excellent, he also does videos. He actually sat down with a police department, and they had uncomfortable conversations. So he also, there are videos on YouTube of his talks, but the book is excellent. Pat had shown it, and I was like, oh, I have the same one.
He's actually going to be speaking at one of the firm-wide events we're having tomorrow where I work, about courageous conversations. So he's our guest speaker, which should be really fascinating. Wonderful.
Wow.
What is his name? What is his name again, Crystal?
Emmanuel
Acho. A-C-H-O.
Okay.
So I'll tell you what, I'm going to buy some for the church.
Okay.
And I'll replace, if you haven't gotten the book that we have out right now, please pick it up. There's left. And then I'll get that for the next book, and I'll order like 10 of them. So you can pick it up if you come to church or in the mailbox. Or if you have Amazon, just order it yourself.
Is that the kind of book that we might want to gather around and have an informal conversation about? Is it that kind of book? I've seen some of the YouTubes.
Yeah.
I think it's pretty cool, actually.
Yeah. There's so many topics that he talks about: systemic racism, reverse racism, implicit bias, white privilege, cultural appropriation. Yeah, I think it is a book you could sit around and talk about.
So why don't we do this? Why don't we just put out another book club? Because we're always doing book clubs, and we used to go into somebody's house, the aunt's house or whoever's house. But let's do this as our next book. And then I'll set a date in April and we'll just have a Zoom call to discuss it. We'll have copies out there, or you can grab it yourself and you can read the book, and then we'll have a discussion like we're doing now, but we'll have more time because we won't present the book. You'll have read it in advance. And you know, we'll try to give a full hour of discussion or so, and then try to do that with some other books. I liked the book, The Church Cracked Open. Has anybody else had a chance to read that? Claire, what'd you think of that?
Oh, it's absolutely, it's a fabulous book. And I think it's one that really would have us all thinking. So Stephanie Spellers wrote that book. She wrote it during the pandemic. And it really is looking at a lot of different issues around the whole issue of what is church and how are we going to be, and what is our real mission, you know, in a changing world. Are we going to have we learned anything from this pandemic? And it's not just the COVID, it's the all of the pandemics that we've faced in the last year. It's very good.
And I think one of the things that I like about it is, you know, you can look at the past like we have in Sacred Ground, and I think that's really important. But when we're really going to change things, what you have to do is start where you are, right where you are as a person, right where we are as people on Long Island, living wherever we're living, and then looking towards this concept of beloved community and how it is that we're going to get there. And more importantly, how we're going to bring others with us into beloved community. And I'm talking particularly about our immediate area. I'm not changing the whole world. I'm not going to change Vermont. I'm not going to change, you know, people who disagree with what we think, but I'd really like to change some of the structural issues, you know, in our school systems, in our police departments, and get a lot of people in a lot of churches and a lot of temples involved in this to really, really make some headway in the coming years. And we can only do that by just admitting about where we are. And I think Stephanie Spellers does a great job of calling you out. If you are sensitive, you may not want to read the book, because she's not afraid to say that we're living in a time of white superiority. And it hit me home hard when I read, when I saw the 60 Minutes. And I've told some of you the quote that ducks hire ducks. You know, part of the big problem in the military is white men hire other white men because they relate best to them and have a very difficult time with people they don't know or understand or are afraid of. And we really need to make some changes, and right here at our church and right here in our community. And I hope you guys will be a part of that and join Racial Reconciliation or the book club or the next Sacred Ground or some of the stuff we're doing in the diocese.
What's the title of the book?
Oh, it's called The Church Cracked Open.
I was just gonna ask, we brought up a bunch of books. Is it possible for someone to email, put together a list of some of these books and send them out?
Yes.
That would be awesome.
Absolutely. Okay.
I will take on that responsibility. Not only will do that, I will buy the books. And I will have them available on our Christian education budget. And I will have some available for you. So you come to church for Palm Sunday or Easter, they'll be sitting on the back and you'll be able to get them. I'll have them in by then. They come in really quick. Or just order them yourselves. I'll send out the list.
Awesome.
And Crystal, if you could help us too. I'd love to get a really good list by age of some of these books that you gave us, not only the ones we did, but some other ones. And then have them for our nursery school and put them into our curriculum. And I love some of the ideas Anne had too, and you know, try to implement them.
I'll help with the list also with that.
Thank you.
And you'll put, Father Duncan, can you put the list of books that we talked about tonight? Is it reasonable to put it in the chalice? I mean, do we have everybody's email here? I think, you know, someplace which is more public where we can say these are some books that, you know, we've talked about from our Tuesday night sessions that you might be interested in reading, and then we'd all see it, so we don't have to depend on an email. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if we have.
I think that's a great idea, Claire, because people who aren't here.
Exactly.
We'll just open it up, and somebody might say, "Wow, that's what that was about. Ooh, let me look and see."
And the other thing is that, you know, to even include the children's books, because, you know, I think, you know, we've been able to have really interesting discussions just talking about these children's books that, you know, that are perfect for kids, but they're perfect for us. And, mm-hmm. you know, I'm just very grateful that we all feel a degree of safeness here in this community. I believe I have made tremendous headway in terms of becoming a beloved community. And I just, you know, cherish this time.
I would like to just add something. I think we've become a beloved community because we are a beloved community. But I'm not sure that means we've made progress with other people outside of this community. And I think we should also be careful. I love the idea of reading and publishing the books and including other people in reading, but I don't want to just stop there. I want the books to be the platform for doing something. And that's where I am concerned that we're talking so much about reading and more learning and not engaging in action. That is my only concern.
Well, that was what my book was about, Heather. Sometimes people march.
Exactly. I do.
But I think, you know, you have to start from a safe place and work out. And we have to be able to see the problem as a beloved community. We have to see it.
Sure. It's the first quadrant. You might fall in that.
Exactly.
Well, I would say that in our little group, which was a wonderfully diverse group, it was informal. We didn't do any reading. We just started talking and sharing experiences. And that, to me, was what was so fascinating about it. Hearing experiences that are not mine.
And I think that's a
such. I see that my internet is unstable, so I will stop talking.
Oh, because.
Maybe it's just me that's unstable.
Action only comes once you have the buy-in from people. And if people feel that it's important, and I'm dealing with this, I'm on the equity team committee in my school district. If you don't have buy-in, people aren't going to act because they have to understand that it's important to them and why it's important to the community and the world as a whole. If you don't have that, no one's going to act. They're just going to say, yep. And that, so I think the reading, I think the discussion leads up to people understanding, oh, you know what? That affected Crystal, or that affected Gladys, or that affected Father Duncan. If it affects somebody that you know, you're going to buy into it and say, like, oh my gosh, I didn't realize you had gone through that experience. What can I do? What can I learn?
I have a question, Crystal.
Yeah.
I had contacted Erase Racism.
Yeah.
And I, because of some personal issues, I haven't been able to get back to them, but Nicole Grennan was happy that I contacted. Is there anybody from our community that's involved in Erase Racism?
I am through my school district.
Through your school district?
Yes.
Because I think another parishioner is friends with the president.
Yeah, and I can't think of her name.
Both Jennifer and her mom, Gladys, know the founder very well. And yeah. They've been involved.
Right, I didn't want to say their names to bring confidentiality, but I know they know them. Mm-hmm. So that's when I get past my personal hurdle, we'll see. I've got a personal hurdle right now, but I'd like to be involved.
Are we ready for the video?
I think we're ready, Crystal. So
this young man, Kedron Bryant, I don't know if anybody saw him, made a very impactful video off the cuff, he and his mom. And I chose this one because it's gospel, it was in the church, but he also has the official music video. It was his reaction to George Floyd. And the official music video is also very impactful, but I loved this one as well. So I chose this one.
Well, I got to see both of them, Crystal.
I know, wasn't the
we
other
put
one? The,
we put the first one in first and then you chose this one. So, but the first one is very, it would really leave us
gut punch.
Yeah, it would punch us. And, you know, we would go out of here like, wow.
Yeah.
But this is beautiful. Let me play it for you all.
Wow.
That just gets me every time.
Incredible. Just incredible, Crystal. Great job. Big hand for Crystal. Thank you so much. Yes. Thanks for the idea. Thank you, Racial Reconciliation and Social Justice Committee, all that helped put this on. And thank you to everybody doing Sacred Ground. There's a couple sessions left and some pretty intense readings. So I'm looking forward to that coming up too. And we'll just move forward together. And I think if you really have something burning in your belly about this, we can make changes. We can do this. So my thanks to all of you. And really, thank you for attending. And thanks for just being a part of St. John's.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Krista.
You're welcome. Thank you, all the other presenters, and thank everybody. Thank really.
You. Thank you, Crystal.
Yeah. Yes. Go in peace to love and serve thank the Lord.
You. Thank you.
Thanks be to God.
Good night, everyone.
Thank you very much, Crystal.
Good night.